वेदांती।
ओके सो हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट ऑडिटरी सिस्टम एंड फंक्शन एंड इट्स इम्पेयरमेंट्स फ्रॉम ऑडियोलॉजिस्ट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. सो आई विल बी कवरिंग ऑल दिस पॉइंट्स इन माय प्रेजेंटेशन. सो फर्स्ट लेट्स हैव इंट्रोडक्शन टू द बेसिक ऑडिटरी सिस्टम. As you can see in this image, there are three parts: outer ear, middle ear, and inner ear. So, in outer ear, there is our auricle and ear canal. Then, in middle ear, there is tympanic membrane and three smallest bones in our body. Those are malleus, incus, and stapes, which constitutes the middle ear. Then, there is very important hearing organ in our whole auditory system, that is cochlea, which constitutes the inner ear. And it is snail shaped and it has got 2.5 turns and it is fluid. So can anybody tell me how do we hear, or do you have any idea?
Y'all can post the answers in the chat box.
Any random guess, how do we hear? Okay, so after the sound is traveling in our auditory canal, it gets impinged on the tympanic membrane. So tympanic membrane vibrates and the three ossicles, that is malleus, incus, and stapes, which are connected to it, it also vibrates. And because of this vibration, the fluid in our cochlea gets displaced, creating a wave across the basilar membrane. So as you can see in this graphic, the sound travels in a form of a wave. So these three parts, which are outer ear, middle ear, and inner ear, any damage happening to these three parts would result in three types of hearing loss. So any damage happening in your outer ear or middle ear, it will result in conductive hearing loss. Anything happening with your inner ear, that is cochlea, would result in sensory neural hearing loss. And in mixed hearing loss, there would be both the components involving your outer ear or middle ear and inner ear as well. So this is an audiogram showing lot of sounds which we encounter in our day-to-day life, starting from rustling of leaves, which is around 5 dBHL, to the highest sound, which is airplane, around 120 dBHL. And the yellow shape which you are seeing is called as speech banana. So in this shape, most of our speech sounds are fit, the frequencies and intensities of those sounds. And on your right side, you can see the degrees of hearing loss. So if the hearing loss is conductive, in terms of intervention, we do not prescribe hearing aid because it resolves with the medications and surgeries. But if it is sensory neural hearing loss, yes, we definitely prescribe hearing aid. And in patients who have severe to profound hearing loss and who do not get significant benefit from the hearing aid, then we opt for cochlear implant. So before moving on to higher auditory processing, I would like to talk about these two terms, that is hearing and listening. So these two terms are absolutely different from each other. Hearing is mere detection of sound, whereas listening would involve the analysis, the understanding and interpretation of that sound. So you would be able to respond appropriately. So for example, if you imagine if you are lost in your thoughts and somebody is calling out your name. So after two to three name calls, you will be like, huh, what? So that doesn't mean you had some hearing loss or you were not hearing properly. No, you were hearing, but you were not listening. You were not paying attention. So that's why you were not able to understand, register that stimulus, and that's why you didn't reply appropriately. So listening definitely involves your attention and it is altogether a different behavioral process. Now moving on to higher auditory processing. So what happens beyond cochlea? After reaching the cochlea sends that auditory stimulus to the auditory nerve, which is our 8th cranial nerve. Then the sound goes to cochlear nucleus, which is situated around dorsolateral side of our brainstem. And one more point is anything happening at cochlear nucleus or before cochlear nucleus would result in only unilateral hearing loss. Whereas anything happening above that level would definitely have devastating effects on your hearing, because there are a lot of decussions and crossovers happening at the level of superior olivary complex. So these all are very delicate and minute and complex structures. So it would have effect on your binaural hearing. Okay. So after superior olivary complex, the sound goes to lateral meniscus, then it travels to inferior colliculus, then medial geniculate body, and then it finally reaches to the auditory cortex, which is situated in our temporal lobe. Just a minute, the slide is not changing.
No problem with that. Do you want me to share yours from here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I think Mihika will have to allow me to share.
Vedanti, you'll have to stop screen sharing first.
Yes, yes.
Ma'am, you can share now.
Is that the one?
Yes, ma'am. So in our central auditory processing, there are two basic processes involved, that is ascending division and descending division. So in ascending division, the sound is traveling up to the brain, and in descending process, the brain is your analyzing the sound, then it's interpreting it, and then it's sending the response stimuli back to the peripheral organs. So what is auditory processing disorder? Any damage happening in this ascending and descending process would result in auditory processing disorder. This is a very good definition given by Jerger and Music. Auditory processing disorder is defined as a deficit in the processing of information that is specific to the auditory modality that may be exacerbated in unfavorable acoustic environments, and that may be associated with difficulties in listening, speech understanding, language development, and learning. So how will you understand that this child might have some auditory processing issues? So these kids peculiarly show some developmental characteristics and hearing difficulties. So these kids would be unable to follow very long and complex verbal commands. Then there would be inconsistent response to auditory stimulation, which we often observe in kids with ASD in very initial stages. Their response to name call is very inconsistent. Then they might repeatedly ask you for repetitions like, huh, what, and they are very poor listeners. Then they have difficulty with auditory localization and lateralization skills. You might observe some discrepancy in performance on verbal versus written instructions, and they get frightened by loud noise, which again we commonly observe in kids with ASD. And their social interaction might be affected because they are not understanding and they are not listening everything 100%. So they might restrict themselves from participating in group situations. then their academic performance is very poor. Of course, there is no direct correlation between IQ and CAPD. But because of, even if their IQ is normal, because of these all these issues, they can be non-achievers or underachievers in school. They have difficulty completing class assignments. Their attention span is very short. And they get easily distracted by auditory or any visual stimuli. And their auditory memory is also affected. Some kids can be hyperactive and whereas some can be hypoactive. One more point to mention here is that if these kids listen for some auditory stimuli for a long period of time, especially speech stimuli, which is very complex and involves a lot of frequency and intensity components, they strain their auditory system and they get easily fatigued if they are paying so much attention for a long period of time. And in older kids, you can observe emotional and social overlays like inadequacy, rejection, unacceptability, and depression. So apart from these behavioral observations, we do this screening checklist, which has got 12 symptoms. Like the kid doesn't listen carefully and doesn't pay attention. His attention span is very short. Or gets easily distracted and has trouble recalling what has been heard or forgets what it said in few minutes. He has difficulty in differentiating one speech sound from another and he has also difficulty following verbal instructions. He shows delayed response, has difficulty relating what is heard with what is seen. He is a poor performer for listening tasks and has got misarticulations and below average performance. So any kid getting yes response for more than 6 questions, that is more than 50%, is definitely at risk for CAPD. So we are talking about this auditory processing, but there are a lot of individual auditory processes involved when we are listening and when we are encountering a lot of various speech stimuli in our day-to-day life. So first is binaural summation or integration. So what is it exactly? So if you are hearing one stimuli from your one ear and another stimuli from your another ear at the same time, but two different stimuli. So your brain is receiving two different inputs at the same time, but still your brain would be able to understand it, combine it, and interpret the message in the end. So that is your binaural summation. So imagine if you are listening to one lecture, your teacher is talking and your friend starts whispering in your other ear. So in this situation, the input you are receiving at your both the ears is totally different, but still you will be able to understand the message. So that is your binaural summation. Then next is binaural interaction. So binaural interaction is same message, but 50% you are listening from your this ear and 50% from this ear. So imagine a moving sound source, which is revolving around you. So sometimes you are listening from your this ear and sometimes you are receiving the stimuli from your this ear in various frequency and intensity components. But in the end, your brain will be able to combine it and understand the message. So that is your binaural interaction. Then binaural separation is something which we encounter very commonly in our day-to-day life. It is like if there a loudspeaker noise going on outside and someone is talking to you. So in this situation, you will conveniently ignore the unwanted noise outside and you will focus on what is the speaker saying. So you will choose the your desired speech input and you will focus on that. So that is your ability to binaurally separate the desired speech stimuli. Then temporal processing is associated with all the musical perception and the rhythm related factors in our speech, like your pauses, then your punctuations, your message intent, so the tone and the intonation and loudness factors. So it is all associated with your temporal processing. Then auditory memory and sequencing is like our Chinese whisper game. And it allows us to remember long and complex verbal messages. And in auditory closure, you are supposed to extract the desired message, even though the background noise or background unwanted stimuli is still going. So for example, you're sitting in a car and there is loud traffic noise going outside, and you get a call from your friend and he's saying, I'll meet you at Dra to eat pav. So this is a random example, but in this whole message you didn't hear the anywhere clearly, but still you will be understand, you'll be able to understand the message. That message was, I'll meet you at Bandra to eat vada pav. So you are still able, even though the background noise is still going on, you're still able to extract the message from it. So that is your auditory closure. So if you are suspecting, okay, this kid might have the auditory processing issues, then how do we go about it? So ma'am, next slide. So first step is detailed case history, and the questions related to child's day-to-day life are very important. So for example, you can ask like, if there are two family members talking and you call out child's name, does he respond to you or does he try to move his head towards you? So such questions are necessary. Then screening test, which we just talked about, it's necessary. Then we do pure tone audiometry and speech audiometry. On pure tone audiometry, these kids rarely get hearing loss, but their speech audiometry results can be very alarming. Because in speech audiometry, what is needed is the clinician gives some words and the child is supposed to hear those words and repeat after the clinician. So their speech audiometry results are very low. Then there is informal assessment and CAPD diagnostic tests. Now, informal assessment is necessary because for diagnostic tests, the proper audiological setup, the two-room setup and standardized test material and audiometer is required, which is not easily available in all the audiological clinics. So informal assessment is very important in such cases. And then we do intervention and management strategies. So these are the diagnostic tests which we use for each process, each auditory process. So for binaural interaction, we use dichotic tests. So dichotic means involving your both ears. Then for binaural interaction, there is rapidly alternating speech perception test and binaural fusion. For binaural separation, there is competing sentence test. Temporal processing deals with all the musical abilities. So these tests are very interesting. The gap detection test, duration pattern test, and pitch pattern sequence test. Then there is auditory memory and sequencing test. And for auditory closure, we do speech in noise tests. So in these tests, there is two talker or four talker babbling noise going on in the background, and you have to extract the desired or target speech stimuli from that background. Next slide. So moving on to treatment strategies. So what will you do for binaural integration? So the dichotic listening training is very important in these cases. So to create that situation, you can have two different recordings on two different mobile phones, and you can put the headphones in child's ear. So he'll be receiving two different inputs at the same time. But you have to start from very basic level. So if we are starting from syllable level, then you can gradually move on to monosyllabic words, then bisyllabic words, and then phrases. Also, some environmental modifications are necessary in these cases. Then for binaural interaction, it is like 50% from this ear and 50% from this ear. So imagine the two speakers are standing at two corners of the room, and there will be giving you the auditory stimuli. So if one this person is saying, I will meet you in the lunch break. So 50% message you receive from here this year, 50% you receive from here this year. So you should be able to combine it and understand the whole message. Then for binaural interaction also, you can have child close his eyes and you can randomly give auditory stimuli from any corner. So he has to localize the sound source. So that is also your binaural interaction strategy. Next slide. Then for binaural separation, this is one process in which kids face most of the difficulty. So you have to focus on their day-to-day life requirements. So we can start from two speakers speaking at a time. Then we can move on to a TV in the background. But first we'll have news channels. So it is relatively easy stimuli to filter out. Then we can move on to serials, and then we can move on to cartoon channels. So for in case of cartoon channels, it becomes little competitive for the kids to ignore that sound completely. And then after this, we can gradually increase the intensity of that competing auditory stimuli which is going on in the background. Then temporal processing activities are very interesting. So all we focus in this is rhythm analysis. So if I'm giving any random rhythm to the child, so like pa, 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 pa. So child has to imitate that rhythm. He can count the gaps in between, or he can count the taps, or he can imitate that rhythm with the taps. Also reading with intonation helps a lot in these cases. And then there is repeating the sequence. So temporal sequencing was also a very important ability. So the sequence has to be in the form of duration, intensity, and pitch. So in duration, it would be like pa, pa, pa. So that is short, short, and long stimulus. Then in terms of intensity, it would be like pa, pa, pa. So that is loud, soft, and loud. And in terms of pitch, it would be like pa, pa, pa. So high pitch, low pitch, low pitch. And it is observed that in most of the CAPD cases, the temporal processing is very affected in children. So these activities helps a lot. Then the auditory memory and sequencing. So it is like our Chinese whisper game. And also you can give long verbal commands and complex verbal commands. But to increase the complexity or to make it harder, we can gradually add some components, like gradually increase the number of items to recall, then gradually increasing the number of items to choose from, or we can introduce a delay in between. So it would be a delayed memory recall kind of thing. Also, we can introduce a distracting task before allowing the child to respond. Also, we can put some time limit in higher cases. Ma'am, next slide. Then auditory closure, that is extracting the sound in even though the background noise is going on. So missing syllable exercises, missing phoneme exercises, and missing word exercises helps a lot in these situations. But what is necessary is, if you want to guess the missing syllable or guess the missing word, your original vocabulary should be good. So apart from the auditory training, we also need to work on the child's language development as a speech therapist. So it would be for his vocabulary building, to improve his syntax, that is sentence structure, and semantic relations, that is relations between the two words. So it would be easier for child to get contextual cues, even if he is not understanding everything, or if he is not able to listen 100% of the message. Okay. So apart from these process-specific strategies, there are some general other management strategies, like a preferential seating arrangement in classroom. So every time the child will be sitting on the first bench, then you can request the teacher to face every time he's speaking to the child. So the child will be able to understand and get the cues from his oromotor area. Also, we can use some exaggerated movement of the articulator. And if the kid gets prior idea of what is going to be taught in the class today or which lesson is going to be taught today, he can have some prior revisions. So even if he's not able to listen 100% in the classroom, it will be easier to get those contextual cues if he has those prior revisions. And in case of kids who still don't get benefited with all these strategies, there are assistive listening devices available. So like Roger. In Roger, there is a mic which is with the speaker every time, And in kids' ear, there will be a device or hearing aid kind of device in his ear. So even though the distance between the speaker and the kid is very far, it won't matter to the child in the presence of any background noise. He'll be receiving the direct input in his ear with all the noise cancellation. And also there are some computer-based auditory training softwares. So there are games, computer games, through which we can teach children, like Otto's World of Sound. Yes, okay. So this is like a summary kind of thing. I have enlisted the factors and symptoms which we observe. So there are auditory decoding deficits, like there is poor discrimination of fine acoustic differences. They need a lot of repetition. Then they have difficulty with reading, like decoding comprehension and receptive language issues. Then in prosodic deficits, there is deficiency in use of prosodic features of target. And the social and pragmatic language would be affected because of this. Then in integration deficits, there is deficit in performing tasks. They have trouble multitasking, and the spelling and written language errors are also observed. Next slide. These are subtypes. There are associative deficits, like they are poor interpreters and they often misunderstand the meaning because the prosodic deficits are there. And they have poor peer relations. Often they are daydreamers, and their receptive and expressive language is poor. In output organization deficits, these kids might be disorganized. They can be impulsive and poor planners. Also, these kids are at risk for deficits in speech production, sequential memory, recall, word finding, and executive function skills. So this is profiling. I'm not going to read it, but I want all of you to have a glance at it. So they have given the lesion, the central auditory test findings, that is our diagnostic test findings, associated sequelae, and management strategies according to each deficit. So the lesion for most of the deficits is auditory cortex and area surrounding auditory cortex. Also, all these processes which we just talked about develop till 6 to 8 years of age, like full development. And some of their processes, like temporal processing and binaural interaction, they go on maturing till the age of 11 to 12 years. Thank you.
So there are a few, questions which I saw, and that's the reason I was getting delayed in putting the slide ahead, is could you give us something, some example of missing word? What is it? Can you please give us an example of missing word in auditory closure?
Okay, so it will be like, I want to go. The go would be missing. I want to go to the bathroom. So here the child has to guess the word. Or the example which I gave, we don't directly start from the missing word exercises. We start from missing syllable and missing phoneme exercises first, which I talked about. Like the I will meet you at Bandra to eat pav. So the da is missing. And then gradually we can move on to missing word exercises.
How do you tackle attention problems, listening and understanding as a speech language pathologist?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
How do you tackle attention problems, listening and understanding, brackets, shift put, as a speech language pathologist?
Okay, so attention comes in a basic prerequisite for language development. It is very important for the development of the child. So if there is, the attention is inadequate, he would not be able to develop the language appropriately. So we'll start, what we do is we basically start from the auditory localization and lateralization skills and the verbal commands which we do, which we give to the child. So very simple verbal commands, and then moving on, the gradually moving on to complex commands. The unidirectional, bidirectional, and multidirectional commands.
The next question is, what would be the screening in 0 to 2 years of child and management or points to be taken care during the rehab?
Okay. So during 0 to 2 years age period, the auditory processes which we just talked about would not be so much developed. But till 2 years, the auditory localization and lateralization should be properly developed. So lateralization is in the space, so above, here and here, and the localization is like in the vertical plane. So those abilities should be properly developed till 2 years of age.
Can you tell us some exercises that can help a CAPD management of a mild case as per assessment?
Okay, first we need to have the detailed assessment, like to target which process is affected. We'll be focusing on that process more, but we'll have the overall management including all the processes. So the exercises which we just discussed now, like for auditory closure and binaural separation, I would be focusing more because the children face more problem in that. So for if I'm tackling with binaural separation, I'll switch on my phone and I'll have some recording at very low intensity and I'll be talking to the child. So if I'm giving him any verbal direction, so the stimulus is going on in the background and he has to give me putting 5 objects in front of him, give me mango and apple. So the child has to focus on me and ignore the background stimulus. So that is a very basic activity for CAPD kids. And then temporal processing should be tackled. The rhythm exercise, the rhythm analysis and rhythm exercises should be done in mild cases.
From my side, I have a question for on behalf of everyone. Can you talk something about prosody, pragmatics and semantics?
Okay.
And one more after that is about coding and decoding, because auditory coding is something as therapists we don't understand as a concept. So prosody, pragmatic, semantics and coding, decoding.
Okay. So prosody is the intonation and rhythm analysis of the message. So if I'm talking like, what are you doing? So that my tone is angry. And when I'm asking, what are you doing? So it is like empathetic. So receiving these cues comes under the development of prosody, understanding the intent of the message. Then pragmatics is like the use of language, the social communication. So if I'm talking to any authoritative person, my tone of language or my tone of message would be very different. I'll be polite. Whereas when I'm talking to my best friend, I'll be all like casual, or when I'm talking to my younger sibling, I might hit him or might shout on him, which I cannot do in case of the authoritative person. So that all comes under pragmatics. And semantics is the meaning of words and relation between words. So if I am giving you one word, the letter, so what will be the associating word? It will be like pen or writing or post, anything. So if you remember that game they play in ZNMD, Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, the friend gives one word and the other one has to say anything that comes into his mind. So that is semantic relation, semantic association. Then ma'am, what was your next question? Auditory coding.
Coding.
Okay. So auditory coding and intensity coding, everything happens in our higher brain structures at the cortex level. So for every speech sound, there is different intensity and different frequency. even though their placement is same. So for example, saying th and th, my tongue is touching the teeth both the time, but in th you can feel the little air burst coming out. So understanding. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, you continue.
Yeah, we can.
So understanding the difference between these two sounds, when I am saying that and when I'm saying that, the meaning, sorry, I'm giving example in Marathi, but the meaning differs here, and which we register in our brain and then we understand its meaning. So these little differences between the intensity and frequency components of the sound all comes under auditory coding and intensity coding.
So when you think of intervention, what do you think about decoding? Because you have written auditory decoding is something what you had mentioned. So how do we apply that?
Okay, so for this, the basic vocabulary level should be good. So we need to work on basic vocabulary first. We have to develop his language to certain limit, and then we can apply these exercises. So there we can use minimal contrast approach. So I'll keep two picture cards in front of the child, which differ in only one phoneme, like tool and pool. So there is difference of only one phoneme. So when I'm saying tool, the child has to pick up the tool card. When I'm saying cool, the child has to pick up the cool card. Or else we can do, the clinician will pick up the card and child has to guess whether I'm picking up the correct card or not. So that would give us the idea whether the child is listening properly and understanding properly.
So when you're treating a child with autism, very specifically, it is not only the what you would look at as a language part of it, but you have to look at the pragmatics, the semantics, because everything gets affected in them, right?
Yes,
the prosody.
Yes.
They won't understand the relationship between people. So they may talk anything anywhere. And that's exactly a challenge which we as caregivers face, whether we are parents or whether we are therapists. I think that is something as therapists, we have to realize that it is not only about communication in terms of getting speech, but when you're looking at a child with autism, it means everything. It means prosody, it means pragmatics, it means semantics. And then the goals which you keep for this child will be very different at different levels. So for parents, it may be just ki wo bolne laga hai, but baat karne laga hai. But contextual reference to personalities, to teachers, and I think this is where they lack. If you see, even when they get speech and they start communicating, I feel the major lack is in prosody and semantics, pragmatics, and all these, even the decoding part of it.
Yes.
Yeah. So next session, we can talk more on this, Vedanti, when we go along on integration part of it. And I will start my part of the talk now. Feel free to add, because this is your topic. So we have limited ourselves to a very different aspect of the auditory system, and not as we deal in the workshop, in the sensory integration workshop. So looking at what auditory system basically is, it serves the role of constructing a perceptual space. It's very important to understand that what is the meaning of a perceptual space? It means that the child or the adult has, or any individual has, a space which is extracting information from the environment and also from the self. So when I was again reading about the auditory system and how the sounds affect an individual, sounds which come from internal, that is your gastrointestinal system, your heartbeats, your respiration, everything makes an impact on you, but you don't realize it because these sounds are integrated in early infancy. Now, our children, the children who come to us as prematures or preterm children, this integration is somewhere lacking. So internally in the womb, as we all know, that listening starts very fast. The auditory system, actually, the hearing starts very fast. Sorry. The auditory system develops very fast in utero. So the child can hear, the child can listen what is happening, but more so internal sounds. And external sounds are limited to the mother's heartbeat, the mother's gastrointestinal system sounds, etc., etc. So all these I found makes a big impact, and I realized then that what we give as auditory integration therapy, we don't really consider what the child may be feeling, and especially children with an integrative disorder have a lot of hypersensitivities to maybe sounds. We feel that, okay, that the child is hypersensitive to sound, but we never understand that they may not be at maybe rest or at peace with their own self or what is happening inside them. So when you're talking about this auditory system and construction of a perceptual space, and how the child derives information, it has to be intrinsic as well as extrinsic. So as we had in the workshops, we usually say, even in terms, like talking in terms of the proprioceptive system, there is an interoception and there is an exteroception. So the same thing happens in the auditory system. The interoception or the sounds which are coming from your body can also cause an impact and are a part of your perceptual space. Second, it definitely engages us in an analysis of the auditory world so that we can start communicating and we can start learning. Now, what do you mean by an auditory experience? And this is something which I found was one of the major functions which we as therapists have never ever thought about. So audition or hearing is an ability to receive sound. We are born with this basic skill. We can't learn how to do it. Okay. We either hear or we don't hear. The ability to hear does not guarantee that we understand the sounds. We are not born with a skill of comprehension. We acquire that as we integrate vestibular sensation. As we interact purposefully with our environment, we learn to interpret what we hear and to develop sophisticated auditory processing skills. Now, which are the processing skills? Of course, she has gone in great details, but what are the basic ones? One is discrimination. That is, we learn to differentiate from sounds. Auditory figure ground disturbance, that is discriminating between sound in foreground and background, and language, that is the meaningful use of words, symbols representing objects and ideas. Vedanti, please feel free to add on in any slide you feel you need to. Want to add on anything to this?
Yes, ma'am. No.
Okay.
Not now.
So because as we know that the vestibular system is crucial for effective auditory processing, a child with vestibular dysfunction frequently develops problems with language. Now, how do these problems play out? Here are some of the characteristics of children with poor auditory language processing. Many seem to be unaware of the source of sound, and they may look all around to locate from where that sound is coming. Many have trouble identifying voices and discriminating between sounds, such as the difference between bear and boar, may be unable to pay attention to one voice or sound without being distracted by other sounds, may be distracted by noises that are loud, sudden, metallic, high-pitched, or by sounds that don't bother others, may have trouble attending to, understanding, or remembering what he or she reads or hears, may misinterpret requests, frequently ask for repetition, and may be able to follow only one or two instructions in a sequence. They may look at others before responding. So this is from The Vestibular System and Auditory Language Processing by Carol Stock-Pranowitz. May have trouble putting thoughts into spoken and written words. May talk off topic. Example, talk about his new shirt when others are discussing something else, like a soccer game. May have trouble closing circles of communication, that is responding to other questions and comments. May have trouble correcting or revising what he has said to be understood. May have weak vocabulary and may use immature sentence structure. May have difficulty in reading and especially loud reading. May have trouble making up rhymes and singing in tune. May have difficulty in speaking and articulating clearly. may improve her speaking ability after she experiences intense moment. So again, what research has shown us and what sensory integration basics have come across is that the visual, the vestibular, and the auditory system, three pillars of language and communication, definitely give rise to a lot of relationship development for a child. So when you're talking about the first slide, what we spoke about, developing that perceptual space, we look at these three systems, the visual, of course, tactile and proprioceptive are contributory, but basic three systems what we look at are the visual, the vestibular, and the auditory. Now coming to audio vestibular, we cannot say it's only the auditory system. For us at sensory integration therapists, a child has an audio vestibular system, not just an auditory system. So congenital and acquired defects can affect all or a part of the system. The peripheral end organ of the vestibular system is the first sensory system to develop. It precedes the cochlear development, that is the phylogenic development of the cochlea, follows that of the saccule, and is developed by 49 days of gestation. The neural connections with the central pathways continue to develop through the 8th month of gestation. Majority of the equilibrium problems in infants and children manifest as balance issues, not vertigo or dizziness. Delayed maturational milestones are typically an evidence of equilibrium dysfunction. So when you're looking at a delay which has come to you without any rhyme or reason, we should always look at a triad of these three systems, and basically auditory and vestibular systems. So when you're looking at auditory, this term auditory, what do you look at basically? One is perception. Second is frequency and pitch determination, intensity, duration, loudness perception, and temporal processing. Vedant, you want to add something in this?
No, ma'am.
Because this is something which again is of great relevance because of the use of different auditory stimuli or auditory equipment, which we call it specifically in the Indian scenarios. When one gives therapy, auditory integration therapy as it is so called, I feel as therapists, we should look at number one is perception. Number two, what is the frequency and pitch, the intensity, the duration. One can't take a rattle and go on. Oh, bacha nahi sun raha. So loudness perception, how loud you can be when you're talking to the child, and temporal processing. So these are various aspects. We will try to go into a little bit of details next time when we are talking of therapy. So this is the development. Hello?
Just one thing I wanted to add. Before perception, the detection is very important, because in ASD kids, what happens is they don't detect the sound. Still, even if they are hearing, the detection is somewhere affected. So the first step would be detection and then perception.
Good. So this is something good. I think that is a wonderful piece of information. So this is something again which I got from one of the research papers which I was reading for this workshop. And this, I think what you said is very, very important. So the auditory system develops at about 20 weeks of gestation. Mihika is messaging me. I think time is getting over. I think we can stop wherever she says. We'll finish after this slide. So the inner buds start to rise anatomically at 4 weeks. The auditory system is developmentally complete anatomically. The anatomy is complete by 20 weeks of gestation. It is about 18 weeks that the nerves conducting the sounds become functional. By 23 weeks, your baby can respond to loud sounds, noises, and may jerk, even begin to hiccup after hearing too loud sounds. At 24 weeks, the auditory system is complete structurally and functionally. Hearing before birth. Fetuses from 6 to 7 months of gestational age have all the necessary mechanisms for the hearing process. It has shown that a premature neonate who is in the 25th week of gestation has good reaction to sound. In another study, presenting vibroacoustic stimuli to a fetus showed that 24 to 25 week fetus also shows a blinking response to sound. So should we stop here, Mika, since you're messaging? I wouldn't mind. I have few.
Yeah. Yeah, I've already exceeded.
Okay. So we'll stop at birth and development post birth and therapeutic connotations or implications. We can
do that.
There's one question asked by Gagan. How do we test or speech frequency? What is it? How do we test or speech frequency as preterms need low frequency? How do we test which voice or sound is low frequency? Vedanti, you want to take that?
Yes, ma'am.
You can see in the chat box where it's written. I didn't get the question. I really didn't understand it. How do we test?
Ma'am, if you can unmute and ask question.
Ma'am, I was reading an article where it was written that for hair cell stimulation, like if it's a 26 to 28 weeker child, they need a stimulation. So if a preterm child, for example, they need that stimulation, but they need it low frequency. So in NICUs, for example, there are so many sounds all around, and even nurses are there. Even when we are talking to the child, or we are stimulating, or the mother is stimulating. So what kind of noise, sound should be used by the mother or by the therapist, which is low frequency? Because it was written that if high frequency is given, it makes the neural connections in a different way. Ideally, it should be low frequency.
So when we test the preterm babies in while doing Vera and all, we specifically do tone burst EBR, which is the frequency of 250 hertz. So 125 hertz and 250 hertz is the basic response which you get for preterms. And what was your other question? Which stimuli should you use while treating? So the basic thing is your basal tone of the cochlea is responsible for high frequencies, and your apex is responsible for your low frequencies. So the sound of rattle or your clap sound, all everything is low frequency. Whereas the cooker whistle and the sounds involving sir, sure, bird chirping, these are all high frequency sounds. Whereas purr, burr, tur are all low frequency sounds.
Okay. Thank you so much.
I hope this answers your question.
Yes.
The mother's voice is the best form of auditory stimulation which a child can get, and the way that the mother should speak, and that's the reason we say being very, very anxiously, definitely the action.
Manu got stuck.
Lost for a second. Am I there?
Yeah. Now we can hear you.
Hello?
Yeah.
So that's what I would say, that the mother's voice. And secondly, one more thing which we have to keep in mind is the heartbeats. When you're doing kangaroo mother care, the heartbeats of the mother also matter a lot. The respiratory sounds of the mother matter a lot. And again, that's the reason why the mother's stress level needs to be kept under control. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, ma'am.
If
yes,
there is ma'am. Anything, then I'm over. Thank you.
Thank
anything
you so
else?
Much.
Ma'am, before we end, Arya has to share some. So we'll be having a handwriting workshop by Dr. Kartik Rao on 29th, 30th, 2nd and 3rd July. So please register with the numbers which are mentioned below.
So Zuili is asking about cochlear implantation that goes into therapy. Zuili, we will be having it in part two next Wednesday. Thank you. Anything else which is there in the chat group? I think that's it, which I can see because I was logged off. Okay. So see you all next Wednesday. Bye-bye.
Bye, ma'am.